This is Denise Peach from the California Department of Aging. I'm the chief of the CVAS branch, and welcoming you today to what is actually our third meeting of our quality work group. It's the first time we did it. We had a kickoff in July of 2015 and just did a webinar and got things started. Then we had our first in-person work group meeting on October 7th, and this is our second in-person work group meeting today. So I want to welcome everybody, those of you in the room, those of you who are joining us via webinar, and I want to just get things started with some housekeeping today. So so we have some new people joining us today, some people who joined onto the work group, so we're going to try to do a little bit of review here at the top of the agenda. But before we do, for those of you who were here last time, you know we had lots of technical difficulties with the people on the webinar, so we're trying to conduct this work group in a way that is productive, allowing for the way life works, that some of you can join us sometimes and some of you cannot. So we do have people who are participating via webinar today, and we'll have you introduce yourselves in just a moment. Last time we met, we didn't do too well with bringing in our webinar participants. So we've got people in the room who are happy to work with and have all of their sleeves and get down to the duties today, but we also want to involve the webinar participants as much as we possibly can. So I'm going to do my best to make that happen, as are our support people here from the Department of Aging. So to get started here, if we could quickly, I want to introduce my team here today, and then have the people in the room quickly tell us who they are and where they're from, what organizations you represent, and then we'll do sort of roll call on the people on the webinar. Also, just want to make sure that I ask that the people on the webinar to remind you that we're going to keep your lines open. And trying to keep the opportunity open for you to jump in and participate in the conversation at any point that you can. But then you have available the ability to text in your messages or type in your messages into the text box. If you're having technical difficulties, we have some support here in the room, so definitely send a chat email saying what your issues are or typing in your need for help, and we'll do our best to assist you. But you definitely need to keep your phones on mute when you're not talking so that we are able to record this session today and post it and make use of it for a later date, and that we don't have disruptions in the meeting. So keep your phones on mute, but we're going to keep you unmuted on our end because we want you to jump in and participate, and we're also going to watch for things that you type in so that we can read them if you can't participate verbally. Okay, so that said, let me introduce my team. I've got Jill Sparrow, who's a manager in the CVAS branch. She's been with us for just a couple of months, and she's getting her wings very quickly around here. So she'll be helping us today, and she'll be answering some of the messages that you type in and participating with us in that fashion. And brand new today, very first day, Eden Rosales, who we have joining us as a new manager in the CVAS branch. She replaces our beloved Willett, who got stolen away from us from the Department of Social Services. Good for them, hard on us, but she got a well-deserved promotion. And so Eden is stepping into Lilith's role. She's very capable and ready to go. We took her from our own ombudsman unit here in-house at the Department of Aging. And then in the back, I apologize to them when I was just down the hall. And then in the back of the room, we have the very capable, technologically minded Adam Smith, who's going to help anybody who's having technical difficulties today. So Adam's always on our webinars here. Data guy, IT help for today. Okay, so that's our team. If we could just quickly go around clockwise and tell everybody who's here today.
I'm Daisy Absalon from Eskaton Adult Day Health Center.
Rebecca Shoup, Long-Term Care Division, Department of Healthcare Services.
Selena Escobar, Manager of Public Programs with HealthNet.
James Kawakami, LA Care.
Gretchen Brickson, Senior Director, MLTSS for LA Care.
Livia Missalides, California Association for Adult Day Services.
Selena Gowdy with Napa Valley Hospice and Adult Day Services.
Lois Sones with Elder Day and Santa Cruz Adult Day.
Great. Welcome, all of you. And that reminds me, too, to remind all of you, for some of us who have naturally booming voices, we are able to make sure that the people on the webinar hear us. If you don't have that give it a little extra wind today to make sure your voice carries so that people on the webinar can hear us. So that's great. And oh, we just had somebody else walk in the room. Give us a quick introduction, Ruth, if you would, because we're just going around the room and saying who's here.
That's great. Hi, I'm Ruth Gay. I'm the Director of Policy for the Alzheimer's Association of California.
Welcome, Ruth. Thank you.
Hi.
Okay, so quickly, we're going to go around on the who we have registered on the webinar, who we see is here. Adam, if you could tell us who these the people are who are registered, and then if you can actually speak and confirm that yes, you're here, raise your voice, and this would be the time for roll call.
All right, first up, we have Amanda Buccina.
Amanda Buccina. Okay, let's try another one. Oh. Hey,
no, good morning. I'm here.
Good morning.
Okay, we have Bob Ario.
Bob? I don't know. If you can, Adam, tell us, speak a little bit louder and tell us where people are from.
Sorry, I'm not sure who Bob's with. His address is at cisadp.org.
Okay, Bob? Okay, next.
We have Christine Flandes.
Christine?
I'm here.
Great, welcome.
Thank you.
Hi, it's Jim.
Hi, Jim.
Hi, Sally. I have a green mucus. I've got a plugged ear. just got a okay. lot of drainage.
All right, they're going there. Yeah. Sure, it sounds like
you're going to call in a Z-Pack. I think he likes to do Augmentin, but I can't.
Let's put our phones on mute, and if we're not speaking with you, it sounds like we got somebody from us.
No, just a lot of coughing.
Okay.
I've had it for a few days, but it's like worse okay. today.
Would you go ahead and keep
Can you yeah. hear me?
Okay, and then Maureen has said all sound has stopped. So there's a few of them out there.
So a few of them that have sound.
Got it. We should be back now.
Okay. So everybody, so those of you who sent notes to us saying that you couldn't hear us, let us know that we're back online. And again, there's always technical difficulties with these things. We're going to do our best to make this work for everybody in the room and on the webinar. And we'll stop periodically to make sure that we bring in the people on the webinar, because this is a participatory thing. I was telling those in the room early this morning that this isn't a performance. This is actually a working meeting, so we want to make sure that we keep focused on the task. Oh, and we have Irina join us late. You want to tell us, Irina, another person who joined us in the room?
I'm from Golden Castle.
Irina, welcome. Okay, so let's get started. We have a lot of work to do today. I want to make sure that we make the most of your time, everybody's clear about our purpose, and that we start making more forward progress towards our goal. So we're going to do at the top here just a little bit of a review to make sure that we all understand why we're gathered here and how we can make the most of our time. So as far as the top of the review, I just want to start by, if we could, just going over some of the things that came up at the October 7th meeting when we were here last time. We had some agenda items and our action items. Oh, actually, let me quickly just go over the agenda today. We're going to do a quick little review of what happened last time, and I want to show you some things that are up on the website so everybody knows what's up there and available, especially for those of you who are joining us for the first time today and you need to kind of review and get up to speed. There's a lot of good material on our website that will help you function and get in here and work with us. So we're going to do that kind of review first, and then we want to talk about sort of end game. What is the product that's going to come out of this work group? And we've done some work sort of thinking about this, and we want to show you where we're going, what this thing is going to look like when we're done, we think, in general, and then we'll get your feedback on that. We want to hear, I'll share a little bit about a meeting that the Department of Aging had with the Department of Healthcare Services and the HSAG. Any of you know the acronyms, the ECRO and HSAG? The ECRO is the External Quality Review Organization that the Department of Healthcare Services works with on all sorts of activities around tracking and measuring outcomes and quality. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that meeting that we had with their quality review organization. And then from there, we're going to hear from the managed care plans about their HRAs. So that was an action item from last time that the managed care plans who participated and worked with us in the meeting agreed that they would bring some information to this meeting about their health risk assessment processes and their documents and how that might inform our discussion about quality. So we're going to spend some time on that today. And then we're going to review a work tool that we've got started for capturing some of the things that are our mandates for doing regarding quality and what we're currently doing, what things we have currently in place, and then we'll start brainstorming around how we're going to do enhance that, add-ons to existing work, strategies for assuring quality and improving quality in CBAS, and we'll talk about how those activities might intersect with things that are going on at DHCS, with managed care, nationally, et cetera. So we'll spend a little time on that tool, and then I think that tool will become something I hope that we work with in between meetings, and that we're able to get some things done and prepared for our February meeting, which will be our next meeting of the work groups. And then at the end of the day, we'll spend a little bit of time, or at the end of the morning, we'll spend a little bit of time just identifying those overlapping issues with the group that's coming in the afternoon. We have an IPC revision work group. Some of you are on both work groups, and there are some overlapping charges that both work groups have, so we'll spend a little time talking about what needs to be passed on to the next work group this afternoon, and we'll review action items, and then we'll be done. So that's the agenda for today. Let's take a quick look, if we could, Jill. I want to just tour around the website and just make sure that everybody's aware of what's on the website, and we'll also show you. This is the CBA website, and the landing pages here for the CBAS activities. On here, there's this button bar that we're hovering over right there. It says HCV Settings Stakeholder Activities. So under here, this is where these work groups have both have sort of come out of. This is the landing page on the CDA website for home and community-based settings, stakeholder activities, and down here you will see a work group button. I can't see it all that well, but I hope that everybody else can. And that work group button, if you click on it, will drop you onto a page that has working documents and it has meetings. So each of our meetings will have a date associated with it. If you click on there, there's a date for each of our meetings. There are slides or materials that were presented, agendas, and any working tools that we use during those meetings. And then there's the work group documents. If we click on that, what you will find is there are charters here for both our IPC revision and our quality groups, and I'll look at those in just a minute. And then if you scroll down just a little bit more, there's some additional buttons that you can hit for work tools that we're working with, background and reference materials, website links, and then any other policy and laws, regs, et cetera, things that are driving our efforts. So it's a really nice website. It's loaded with stuff. We're going to continue to load it with stuff so that this is a completely transparent process that as many people as possible can participate in. So that that's what we've got loaded up out there. Let's do a quick look at the quality charter, if we could. I just want to note again for the new people that are joining us today, want to make sure that you're aware of what the charter of the work group is. And there have been no revisions to the text of this since last time, but I do want to just point out that we have added a number of new members, so that's great. We've had people who want to volunteer to participate. And so long as you're here to work, we're happy to have you. Okay, so just quickly, just want to say the purpose of the group to develop a quality assurance and improvement strategy for CVAS that includes metrics for tracking and improving participant outcomes and the quality of care delivered by CVAS providers. So it's kind of a, I try to think of it as a four-part thing. So there's going to be a strategy, and the strategy includes assuring quality, and we're going to talk about that today about how we need to make those assurances to CMS, et cetera. So assuring quality and improving quality. And then it's at the provider level and at the participant level, okay? So we're going to be looking at provider performance and outcomes delivered by providers for participants, and we're looking at quality assurance, the basic things that we need to say that people are meeting standards, and then improvement measures that we want to focus on. So that's what the strategy is going to encompass.
And Lynn says there are new charter documents. Will be
uploaded. Right. Okay. So thank you, Lynn. Lynn's mentioning that we're gonna load up these. These are right now not updated. These are on the website, but we have new documents. Actually, if you wanted to pull that up, and it'll show some of the new members. That's in our file folder there. If you look up the charter for quality, you should be able to see the document that Lynn has updated with us with our new members. So if you open it up just a little bit there we go. So there you go, slide that. Yeah, so it'll be the charter document, the third one now. So if we look at the charter, again, this is the updated one that's not on the website yet, but it'll be posted, and it has some of the new members that have volunteered to participate. So thank you, everybody, for your participation. And again, new members, definitely acquaint yourself with the website and with the charter document itself. So Jill, if you'd go quickly to the... what do we want to see? The action items from last meeting for quality, and we'll just review that. And while we're doing that, could the new people who came into the room introduce themselves?
Hi, I'm Chris Christie with DAOP.
Oh, welcome.
Hi, I'm Liz Machado with DAOP down south in Imperial Valley.
Great, thanks you guys for coming up. Okay, so getting started here with a look at the action items from last time, and many of these things we have incorporated into our agenda and into our plans for today. So what I want to just focus on here is that we said last time that we were going to distribute the all plan letter that actually hadn't gotten finalized yet. That was on facility site reviews. So Oksana Meyer from DHCS, who was here last time, talked about that being released. It was in fact released. We at CDA distributed it out to all of our CVAS providers, so they were aware of what was coming. During the CADS conference in November, we had presentations from several of the Southern California managed care plans. They talked about the facility site reviews and what were going to be happening, so that providers and everybody is sort of on the same page about these reviews and what they were going to, how they were going to be taking place. So that's been done, and we probably will touch on it a little bit today as it relates to some of the things we're thinking about with regards to our own quality assurance measures. Number two, follow up with DHCS about the ECRO and the focus study for CVAS. So I'm going to report out on that in a little bit later this morning, but that's, again, what Oksana Meyer from DHCS told us last time, is that we thought we might be able to get in on some of the department's efforts to do focus studies with their independent organization for reviews, and we did, in fact, get that grant. We're thrilled to be able to do that, so I'm going to report out a little bit on that today. So that's going to inform our activities. Number three there, follow up with DHCS about the facility site review tool, and so we have a little bit more work to do with DHCS around that. So we have conversations going with the managed care division about that. Four, develop the quality strategy report framework. We're going to talk about that later today. We did that. Develop the quality strategy work tool. We did that. We're going to work on that today. Number six, request DHCS data, percentage of participants in CalMedic, et cetera. That's on our to-do list still. Again, we have that working with Oksana and her folks, so I hope that we'll have that in between meetings or at our next meeting. Number seven, review all plan letter on care coordination. So that's sort of still on our to-do list, but we know we have overlapping care coordination issues. Care coordination might be one of the areas where we're working on improving our efforts, and so we know that we need to make sure that that's coordinated with what's happening on the managed care side. update work group at future meetings on NADSA quality activities. So that's a Lydia and a CAD sort of pending item for as we go forward with efforts with the quality work groups that CAD's doing, that we get a future report out from you. Managed care plans to report on health risk assessments. That's happening on today's agenda. We're posting materials on the CDA website. That's in progress. Distributing the Survey Monkey for the December date when we did that. So that's our action item list. Woo! In a hurry. Okay, so we have a few things that are still carrying over, but want you to see that we're making progress. Okay? So if we could, let's pop back out to our agenda today, and then let's roll up our sleeves and get started with some things. First up, if you would pull up Jill, where are we time-wise? So I'm going to stay on time here. Keep me honest. Okay, we're good. We're ahead. Okay, great. So what we want to do is overview our quality strategy framework document. So we at the Department of Aging and Department of Healthcare Services are keenly aware that many of you participate in many work groups, task forces, et cetera. We want to make sure that we don't have anybody, we don't want to spin our wheels here, we don't want to waste anybody's time, we want to make the most of your time and your brain power and energy. So we want to make sure that everybody's clear about where we're going. What's the product from this effort? Okay, so this is just a very, very rough draft of what we believe is going to be the framework for the end product of this group. We're going to have a strategy. We're going to have a written document that makes makes some commitments. To some things based on what we're charged, what we're required to do. So what we have done in trying to arrive at what a framework will be is we've looked at all the existing strategies that are out there. Maybe not all of them. There's a whole bunch of them. But primarily we're trying to align our efforts with things that are going on at DHCS, the federal level, et cetera, around quality. So the way that we envision this is that we're going to have a final document that's going to look like this. There's going to be some kind of an overview that provides a purpose and background information about what it is we're doing, no surprise, it's going to reflect back on what the 1115 waiver commits us to doing around quality, what the laws and regs commit us to doing around quality, et cetera. So we'll have an overview section. We'll talk about all of you, the stakeholders who have been involved in developing this strategy with us and the activities that we've undertaken. We will have some kind of a discussion about our focus areas, so CBAS priorities and domains, and I'll show you some of what we've been looking at here. So with regards to things that are going on, again, existing activities that we have going on, things that are going on at the federal and state levels regarding quality and monitoring requirements, and then any additional activities that we want to take on after we flesh them out through this work group. Commitments we want to make to further meeting those priorities, and then the relationship of these to the other these CBAS priorities and domains to other quality activities going on. So there'll be some kind of a connection between what we're doing in CBAS and what's happening elsewhere. Then we're going to have some explicitly stated goals, objectives, and strategies for assuring and improving quality. So we'll get into talking about some of the things we're doing. And again, we've just thrown a few things here just so people get ideas about, well, we're going to be looking at standardizing some forms and some processes and some reporting. Revising the IPC is one of those things, the individual plan of care. And mining current data, collecting new data, et cetera, to further sort of quantify and qualify how we're doing. Oversight and monitoring activities, I think that we're going to have some discussion, I hope even getting it started today, about some of the things that we can change in existing monitoring and oversight activities that might better flesh out, demonstrate performance, assure performance at the provider level, and better get at quality. Promoting evidence-based practices and best practices that will drive quality improvement, training. I think we heard a little bit from Ruth last time, and I've actually had some conversations with some CBAS providers between last meeting and this on some great ideas that Ruth has floated, and some ideas for improved training activities and how we might leverage that between provider organization, CDA, DHCS, and managed care plans, and then transparency of reporting. Yes.
Diane has a comment.
Okay.
So she writes, I would like to suggest the addition of CADS to the list of other quality activities.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. So great, Diane. So I think that, I think we intended that under what's happening with the NATSA activities, because I know you guys have been aligning there, but yes, absolutely. We can have CADs in there. So again, this is a really draft document to just show you just the major areas, and then the final section there on this document, it is just that we'll have the specific activities, milestones, and timelines laid out. So what it is we're specifically sort of committing to, so everybody knows where we're going, right? Over what period of time. So if you would you just pull up, Jill, just so we can see as a point of reference, the DHCS quality strategy. And again, so we're doing our best to align what we're doing with what DHCS is doing, managed care. We're not trying to add on additional burdens. We're trying to work, in sync, but have something that's uniquely speaking to CVAS and to CVAS quality. And again, from my perspective, in demonstrating existing quality, demonstrating existing qualities of, characteristics of populations served and outcomes being delivered, and then doing our best to drive the quality discussion a little bit further. So here's the DHCS quality strategy, really pretty cover. I don't know if we'll have something like this. I think they probably spent a lot of money on a nice consultant. So we're doing our work ourselves, but we'll do our best to make ours pretty. If you scroll down, Jill, I want to just show everybody. This is on the DHCS website, and we'll put a link up on our website to this so everybody can see it. The table of contents, it sort of lays out some basics about what the priority areas are. And if we just scroll down, I just want to focus on that one page, just a little bit of background here in their introduction. Again, we're going to try to mirror ours. And then here are the three linked goals, which basically are the triple aim goals that improve quality and populations. So here it's improve the health of California, enhance the quality of the individual patient experience, and then reduce the department's per capita health care program costs. So these are the same triple aim objectives that are happening at the federal level. Everybody's working on these same main goal areas: improve overall health, improve individual experience of individuals, and then reduce costs, bend the cost curve. And so then the three linked goals then lead into the seven priorities, and again, these are the DHCS priorities that then translate down to managed care plan quality efforts, et cetera. So this is sort of the overarching principles. And so we have the seven priorities are to improve patient safety, deliver effective, efficient, affordable care, engage persons and families in their health, enhance communication and coordination of care, advance prevention, foster healthy communities, and eliminate health disparities. So I don't know. You guys have been hearing my voice for a minute. If we could just stop and just think about that for a minute and which of these areas that we can see that we already sort of intersect with. If anybody has any comments about any of these areas, love to hear your thoughts, how they might relate to CVAS and what we're doing here. Too soon? Well, let me throw a thought out. We have in one of our primary charges in the 1115 waiver is that we have to assure patient health and participant health and safety. Okay, so right at the top we have improved patient safety. So
those three would be like the person-centered care plan and the right things working on
it. Sure, absolutely. About coordination of care. I mean, who's not working on coordination of care right now?
Right, and it also aligns with the offline letter 1410 that we talked about, our coordination.
Right, the coordination mandates that the managed care plans have regarding working with the providers and coordinating beneficiary care.
Correct.
Absolutely. So there's a ton of overlap here. Yeah, Lydia, I saw you.
Oh, no, I was just looking. A couple of them are really more at the population level.
Uh-huh.
So to the extent, like you said, Denise, that we can identify quality strategies that support what our managed care partners are
yes.
already engaged in, that's where the intersection would come. But a number of these really are more population health related. But we can contribute to that
absolutely.
Success.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I think they're all great.
Right. And I think that, again, I'm just showing you this to just show you where we're sort of trying to extract what's going to go into our strategy and make sure that we're all lined up and we're not creating anything new here. We're just trying to think through the CVAS lens to getting to these things.
And if anyone has any, they can raise their hand, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. Anybody out on the webinar, please join in. We're just trying to get you some preliminary thinking here on the seven priorities. Ruth, you want to?
Yeah, well, just given the fact that there's some kind of broad goals as well that are kind of,
yeah.
I wonder if we would want
to have some type of a goal that also allows us to grow the program while maintaining quality assurance of some kind.
Right, great.
I don't know, you know, what that means, but I'm assuming that with the growing population, I would just think that over the years, we should have a planned growth, because otherwise these will become obsolete. They won't serve other people to meet the needs.
I like it, because we are in the growth mode right now. Absolutely need to keep our mind on quality at the same time. Yeah, we have something, Jill?
Yes, Diane has a comment. In thinking through the CBAS lens, it's essential to think through the ADHD lens as well and consider those served in our programs who are not funded by Medi-Cal.
Diane, this is always a Diane point, and thank you again for reminding us, yes, that CBAS is the Medi-Cal benefit, that ADHCs are where the services are provided, licensed adult day healthcare centers that serve private pay participants. So thank you, Diane. As always, you remind us of that fact, that you're broader than CBAS, and we need to think about all of the things that you're delivering in your centers. So thanks. Anybody else?
I had one thought from Ruth's comment, which is, I don't know how this links or if the plans have any thoughts on this, but is access part of quality? In other words, if you don't have timely access, if you don't have access to quality services, if you don't have sufficient services, is that linked to quality? And I'm trying to read into those seven priorities, and I don't really see it explicitly there, but I think that links with what Ruth was just talking about.
Yeah.
That we want to sustain access to quality services.
Mm-hmm. Gretchen, do you want to say something?
We actually, when we are audited, they look at something they call access and availability as a separate category from quality.
From quality, okay.
And what they want us to show, so far what we've been looking at is time and distance standards. So are there sufficient number of CBAS centers in Los Angeles so that people don't have to be in the van more than an hour, which is your standard? But we've been also tightening it up a little bit, because ideally it would be more like 20 minutes or something like that.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Yeah, and I know that CMS is beginning to work on that. I think I just got a meeting invite for next week to start talking about that within the department, about CMS guidance that's coming out about access standards that don't exist anywhere except for with the personal care physicians. But CMS is interested in doing it for home community-based services as well. Yeah. Ruth.
So, and again, this might be, you know, what I see in the programs that are existing, that this already sort of exists. But my thought is, I wonder if we want to say something about, you know, you're talking about access and quality, but serving the diverse needs of the community, or making sure that we take into account the cultural competency that might be required to meet the needs of that community as we develop our quality.
Right.
Because to me, that makes a difference depending on who you're serving, and it varies from community to community.
Yeah. It's great points. So,
Diane has another comment. It also links to why I was focusing on the ADHD aspect, because of the need to communicate the nature of this kind of program to consumers generally, but both Medi-Cal and other.
Yeah, it's a great point. I'm going to really quickly pull up, just we're going to be getting into this later when we work on the tool, but what I would like to do is just show you, because again, I want to make sure everybody's clear that we're not making any of this up here, that we've been charged with certain responsibilities. And so these are excerpts from the 1115 waiver for CBAS, and it says, the state shall maintain a plan for oversight and monitoring of CBAS providers to ensure compliance and corrective action with provider standards, access, and delivery of quality care services. So if you look at the things that we are reporting all the time to CMS, one of Rebecca's staff is dogged me just this morning to make sure that I get my feedback to her for the report that goes out, our quarterly reports where we report to CMS what's happening with regards to all sorts of things, activities in the program, but includes access. So we have the first one, this is what we report on all the time, enrollment information, including fee-for-service and Medi-Cal managed care beneficiaries in each county, the capacity, the total determined eligible, total determined ineligible,
all of those numbers that we collect from our CVAS providers, that the managed care plans report out on, we report those up to CMS. So access is definitely a piece of this. So that's STC 99 in our waiver. And again, for those of you on the phone, all of this information is on our website at CDA. And then if you look at special terms and conditions number 100, this is the actual STC that addresses quality assurance and improvement strategy. We're going to dig into this later on. But the first thing, it talks about quality and implementation of the beneficiary's person-centered plan, the provider's adherence to law, licensure and certification requirements, and then there's financial oversight and administrative oversight of the plans that is part of the DHCS's larger plan. Did you have to say
that? Yeah, I just kind of want to touch back on what Lydia was saying about is access a part of quality, and I think I think it needs to be further defined, because access could be simple things like time and car, distance to provider, availability of provider compared to the need of the member population. That doesn't necessarily speak to quality, and being able to measure, do we have access to quality providers and quality of care, we really have to define what is quality within mm-hmm. the CVAS center, and then on top of that layer, on top of that, the access to those types of quality services. Mm-hmm. So, I think Lydia does bring up a good point, but it's a little bit more than just let's measure access and see how we comply with access, mm-hmm. and let's measure quality and see how we comply with quality, because it could be two different things that we're measuring separately in silos and not being able to get to, do we have access to quality services?
Sure. They both go hand in hand.
Yeah.
But I think that we haven't even begun yet to do what I think that Gretchen is talking about LA Care is doing with trying to pay attention to time in van. And, I know there are other issues around access that we're starting to look at, things like wait lists, the geographic areas where it's impossible for the plans to get access to care for CVAS without having somebody on a van for 2 hours. Or there's a wait list and there's no availability.
And I think cultural linguistic capability is important, as well as for the need of specialized populations, mm-hmm. behavioral health.
So Denise, too, I wonder if this conversation fits in with your thinking about the potential startup of new sites, and is quality, as we begin to define it, going to be part of that, does this effort become regulatory in a sense?
Yeah.
Because it is part of the waiver requirement and so on?
Yeah, I think that's an outstanding question for us.
Okay.
And as we, for those of you who aren't aware, we just recently began working with prospective new applicants. Mm-hmm. We haven't even gotten to people actually filing applications, but basically the process is designed so that we have a pre-screening. So interested parties are just now beginning to ask for packets to give us program plans and designs and whatnot. So our authority is what it is in our statutes and regs around what's in an application, what the process is, what timelines are, and all that. So when it comes to qualitative measures, we get into some squishy areas there, but certainly our process is designed so that prospective applicants have to say, this is who we are, this is how we're prepared to do whatever it is we need to do, this is where we want to set up shop, this is the level of need that's there, and then they're going to be reaching out to the managed care plans to say, do you want to partner with us? So all of those things are part of the process. So trying to get as much at getting preparation in place for readiness for performance. But when it comes to it, at the end of the process, it's does managed care want to buy what you're selling? And so we can look at what things we can make more formal in policy. Yeah, Ruth.
So this is more of a question, I think. So when you talked about the programs across the country really meeting the same kind of requirements if you're in adult day health or if you're a CVAS model, are we being held to a certain level of sameness, if you will?
Yeah.
Same look, same see, same services, sites across the country?
Yeah.
And is that something that we have to pay attention to, or can we kind of innovate our own?
Right.
It's such a question. question. I honestly don't know how many there are.
Yeah, and you know, I don't know the answer. Maybe others have some thoughts on this, but when I was at the SCAN Long-Term Care Summit recently, we went to the quality presentation. Jenny Chin Hansen was there from NQF. I can't remember the woman from NCQA. They talked about what's happening nationally. We're trying to pay attention to it, yes, absolutely. But as far as they're not there yet, you know, so we're kind of building something that's not there, and maybe California is just sort of out front here. But absolutely, we're paying attention to what's happening nationally, but we need to be moving forward as well.
So, and I'm just going to add something then. If that's the case, you know, just looking at some recent data that came out, looking at the number of people with dementia in the Medi-Cal population, I'm wondering if having something about dementia competencies mm-hmm. is going to be important across the yeah. board, because we know that these folks will be served in these programs whether or not they're prepared for it. And so if yeah. that might be a piece of quality
yeah. Yeah.
where we can actually speak to the competencies that somebody
right.
can provide,
yeah.
knowing that they recognize and can serve that person whether or
right.
not they're formally identified.
Right. It's a great idea. I heard it from you last time. I heard it from several people after the meeting, and I think that when we get into our work tool exercise here in a little bit, I think we're going to talk more specifically about existing processes that we have in place for monitoring and oversight and ensuring that certain kinds of training are done. I think it's an add-on possibility there. So let's talk about it when we get there. For the purpose of staying on the agenda, I know we have managed care plans that are on webinar who are ready to present to us about HRAs, and so I want to stay true to the agenda as much as we can. So if we can move on and talk to the item on the agenda, managed care plan health risk assessments, and a quality discussion around that. We don't really have a special order for things, but I do know that we have the LA Care people. We're trying to get Anna Edwards on right now. Is she
yeah.
is she on and ready
yeah,
to go? Back to Anna, or put her on mute.
Yeah,
she
needs
to
turn off her computer microphone.
Okay. And then in the meanwhile, Gretchen, did you want to give us any little setup from your perspective before we bring Anna in, who's the expert?
We could go ahead
go to somebody else first. Okay. Fair enough.
Okay.
Selena, are you ready to give us anything
sure.
on health risk assessments from HealthNet?
Sure. So I put together some quick points here on our health risk assessment process. Many of you are aware that HealthNet uses a vendor to assist us with the outreach for HRA completion. And I'm sure the other plans can speak to this as well. It's been challenging at times to obtain the correct contact information for many of our members. Once we receive our 834 files or information from the state, and because of that, we have higher numbers than what we would like that are considered unable to locate. And then many that are also unwilling to participate. So, and that's for a variety of reasons. And so what we've done as a result of, or to gain more HRAs being completed, and really the importance of those is to assist us in determining, you know, what other needs does a member or participant have? How can we connect with other providers to put together an ICT or other.
You want to tell everybody what an ICT is, just in case anybody doesn't know.
An interdisciplinary care team.
Great.
Thank you. And so we've come up with some creative ways and identified among our LTSS providers and participants and matched them up. So CVAS, you know. Who are CVAS participants? Who are our MSSP participants? And what is their status of HRA completion? And so we've just, you know, come up with that analysis. And now what we are doing is reaching out to those providers, especially CVAS, and asking, can you please help? You know, we need your support and partnership. This is a way, you know, that we can connect and strengthen that relationship. And, here are your members who have this status or this status. And so we've come up with some incentives, but really it gives us the opportunity to get to know that center a lot better and all of their participants that well, our health net members that they're serving. So that's we're just starting to roll that out right now and hoping to see, you know, where that goes and crossing our fingers that we see an increase in completion rates and have also developed a couple different ways for those providers to submit that form, the HRE packet, because, you know, it's pretty lengthy. I think there are 40 or so questions.
Are you asking the CVAS provider and MSSP to complete the HRA for the participants that they know more intimately?
Correct. Correct. So let's everybody speak up because I just want to make sure, because that's a great, you know, clarification.
Right.
HealthNet is asking some of the CVAS providers to assist with developing the HRA.
Will you partner with us? And someone told us no.
Yeah.
No, and that's okay. You know, we can come up with some other ways, but if you are, I think it's just so valuable. I mean, not only for the plan, but for the member, you know, for the participant. And again, it gives us the opportunity to go to the center or to talk with them over the phone in person and find out other ways. So it opens the door for more interaction and more partnership, but starting with that HRA, which is so key for all of our members, especially our CVAS participants.
Right. So Anna just said she signed out of the webinar. But she's still on the phone. So are you able to let her back in? I think that'll help with this.
Can I just ask? Okay. So yeah, let's questions like Selena for we're working on LA Care.
So with you know, having better success rates in completing HRAs, have you taken opportunities to find different ways to administer the HRAs, potentially leveraging the CVAS centers and getting them to do it face-to-face? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Yes. So we have set up a provider portal. I think many of the plans do. And that's one way that the centers can directly complete the form online. So in real time, they don't have to write it and then go in and complete it again. So they could, whatever their preferred method is, you know, either over the phone with the member or their participant, in person with a participant and doing it, you know, on paper, if that's easier, fine, or in front of the computer and completing that, you know, directly to our portal as well.
And so, Selena, you're providing, paying them to complete the HRA, is that the incentive?
We are providing some incentives, so again, if they're willing to assist us, we can, you know, incentivize them for that. And like I said, some have said no, you know,
what?
And I was surprised.
Yeah, that's
right.
Yeah. Why are they saying no? I'm curious, yeah.
I was surprised. You know, we've made it as simple as we could. We have just a one-page we call it an application, but really it is a one page that just asks for center contact information, center name, so that we can just document that you're willing to participate. And we know it's not, you know, you're not going to get rich from completing the HRA, one per, you know, per participant who has it, who doesn't have one. But it gives the, you know, a little bit of money to help with supplies or activities or some transportation expenses, whatever.
Well, that's why I was wondering why people, yeah, because when we, during the transition, Partnership Health Plan, you know, paid us to do the HRAs, and it was a real way that we could be supportive to the health plan, and we knew the participant a lot better, and so we could give them really good data, you know, related to that. So I think it's just a win-win in terms of that partnership.
You know, it may still be the misconception that it's going to take a long time, or they don't have maybe the resources to spend that extra, you know, what, 20, 30 minutes to complete. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is this something you're doing for all your members? Or
particularly, we're focusing on CalMedi Connect members right now in the Los Angeles and San Diego County areas, where the bulk of our members are anyway. So, yeah, we're starting there, and it's been a little bit slow, but it's available. So, yeah.
Some more questions? Oh, really?
Yeah, just logistically, you know, I heard a lot about these HRAs being problematic and challenging in some ways. How are you guys handling, like, do you have a contracted agency that actually goes in and completes those ones that are not completed if the if the CBAS centers won't fill them out, or if you have other, how are you gathering that information then if indeed you're kind of running into these barriers?
Right. So we, this is our plan B, you know, our plan A, you know, it is, and it's still ongoing that we have a vendor who's reaching out, you know, by phone and by mail, and that's where our original data is coming from, and where we see the numbers of unwilling to participate or are unable to locate.
So there might be an opportunity here for our group to talk a little bit about how we might get more CBAS providers engaged and interested in partnering with the managed care plans. I think it's something for us that talk about in this group. So if I could for just a moment, there is an alternative if we need to get Anna on the line. We do have a conference line here we could call.
Actually, she's on the phone.
Okay, so Anna, you there?
And, yeah, let me just introduce Anna. Are you there, Anna? She said she was hearing us.
Okay, so if we need to, if we have a regular phone, we'll just call her on our conference line. So if you want to just set that up for me, Gretchen, you just give me the number and I'll dial it while you're giving us an overview.
It's funny that she said she was hearing us.
Just write and give me the phone number and I'll dial it. It's going to be worth it, Anna, when we get there.
She's still saying she's muted by us.
Okay, are you muted? You got to
mute now? We have her on the phone, so let's see. If,
okay, but we don't have her on the phone. We have her. She's coming through there. If you just give me her desk phone, I'll call her desk phone.
Okay.
So while we're
just
doing,
take a minute.
Yeah, it's okay. While we're doing this, if we have CalOptima on the line, or Kathy, if you're there, or if we have, it was from Anthem. Is Kathy there?
On the line,
Osborne.
Yes.
Kathy Osborne needs to enter her PIN, and then who we have Amanda from Anthem.
Amanda and Christine Blendon.
Amanda and Christine, if one of you guys can get started, we'd like to hear from either CalOptima or Anthem at this point.
This is Amanda. I'm having a little bit of a difficult time hearing. Are we, we're talking about the health risk assessments, and can everybody hear me?
Yeah, we hear you great, Amanda. Thank you.
Okay. So I did find out a little bit more information about our HRAs. And I actually got a copy of all of our questions. The so most of the timelines for the HRAs are determined by the state, and so how we handle these HRAs is that each month the state sends us a list of every FPD member who is new to the Anthem plan, and they are already stratified into high risk and low risk by a state stratification system. And so for those members who are deemed high risk, we must complete all of our outreaches and attempt to complete that HRA within 45 days. And for the low risk, it's 105 days. Our calls are made out by live staff. It's not a it's not an automated call, and they make two telephonic outreaches to people. And if both of those telephonic outreaches are unsuccessful, they send the member an unable to reach letter. And it does give them a number to call back in case they would like to complete the health risk assessment. The assessment is, there's the number of questions varies depending on how they answer some of the questions. For example, if someone says that they have been in the hospital recently, or they have been to the ER recently, then they will ask additional questions about, you know, what they were hospitalized for, if they remember where they were hospitalized, and that kind of thing. But it looks like there are basically around 30 questions that are mandatory that the staff ask that person, and then the questions can become more lengthy depending on how they answer those questions. We really ask about if they need a translator, what kind of help they currently have at home, if there's a support person that we can speak with, if they have a medical condition, if they know what to do when that condition gets worse, or if it becomes more difficult for them to manage, if they have a doctor that they see regularly, if they have specialists, if they have difficulty getting to that doctor, if they need help scheduling appointments, if they've been hospitalized, if they use any DME, what kind of medications, I'm sorry, how many medications they take daily, if they have any problems taking them or getting them filled, if they have any behavioral health issues, if they take any behavioral health meds, if they have housing, if they have difficulty paying energy or utility bills, if they do receive any in-home support services, or any other types of services in the community like Meals on Wheels or any services through the county. And then they also ask if we can speak with their physicians if needed, and if they would like a case manager or a social worker to contact them. If, depending on how they score on the HRA, they will be sent to our case management team. And then also, even if they score low, but they say that they do want a case manager or a social worker to call them, then they also get sent to our case management team to be assigned. And you said that you wanted to know what kind of data we track based on this. So there is data that we track, and the majority of it is based on what the state requires that we report to them about the HRAs. So we track the number of people that we reached and completed the HRA, how many members were stratified high by the state, and then after they answered the HRA questions were determined to be a low risk, and vice versa. How many members were stratified low by the state, but then after we asked the questions, they came out as being stratified high. We report all of the HRA scores. We report how many people declined. And then they create cases in our documentation system on all of these referrals. So if we want to, we can track data about how many were referred to case management, et cetera, but we don't currently track that.
Amanda, is that everything that you wanted
that's
to share?
That's everything.
Okay.
Yeah, that's everything, unless you guys have questions.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to ask, if anybody has any questions for Amanda. Amanda, I know that we've got Tatiana from your shop out on the line, too, who's ready to answer or participate if there's any questions for her.
Can I ask a question? What did you say again, that you're not tracking the ones that are referred to case management? Is that what you said?
Correct. We don't, but if we wanted to, we have all of that data available, so we can pull it if needed.
Okay. Good to know. Yeah, Lydia has a question for you, Amanda.
Hi, Amanda.
Hello.
Two questions. Similar to HealthNet, are you reaching out to your CBAS centers to help complete HRAs? And if so, are they getting any reimbursement? And then number two is, are you generating referrals to CBAS on the basis of the HRA results?
We aren't. We are not generate. We're not doing either, actually.
Okay.
But that's a really good idea. So we don't generate a CBAS referral based on the outcome of the HRA, but okay. For all of those, our case managers are aware of CBAS, so once they reach out to that member and make contact, that's something they talk to them about.
Okay, so it's going via a live staff person who is already somehow connected with them.
Correct.
Okay.
All right, more questions for Amanda. Ruth?
And this might be a question, Amanda, or you guys both may have answers to this, I was thinking. As part of the HRA process, do you all have a way of identifying if somebody has cognitive impairment, for instance, that you can talk to a caregiver? And if so, is there a way to document that in health plan so that if, in the HRA so that it becomes part of the record that people can see? I just don't know.
Yeah. We do. We ask them if they have a caregiver or a support person, and then they ask if we can speak with that person and the best way to get in contact with that person. And, you know, that's a really good question about what happens then. So the information that's in this assessment is documented. But it's kind of a separate process. So it is documented in our system, but that person wants actually to have, wants to formally designate somebody to speak on their behalf with Anthem. That's a different process. And then they would actually fill out a form that we have with Anthem, and then that would be accessible by anyone within Anthem.
Sounds like there might be some opportunities there. Maybe we can,
identify caregiver is another challenge, and so that's part of our care coordination on our tool, our care coordination form. We're asking for CVAS providers to help us. You know, can you help us identify a caregiver and even a backup caregiver for the member, because at the plan level, we often don't have that information, so we're relying on our providers to share that with us if they have it.
So that's Selena from HealthNet, by the way, for those of you who aren't on the line, aren't in the room. Selena Regalia.
This is Selena. I have a question for both of the health plans. I was just wondering, like, the nuances between when somebody's referred to care coordination and then the development of the ICT and how that process flows.
I think Anna is on and can be unmuted now, and she's given a lot of good information about that.
So do you want to, Anna, are you there? First of all, let's make sure Anna's there.
Hi.
Yay, Anna is there. Okay, hang on just 1 second. Let's finish this question in the room.
And I just want to say Anna is our Director of Case Management at LA Care and an expert on all things HRA.
Great. Okay, hang on, Anna. We're going to finish this in the room and then we'll come to you.
Care coordination and the ICP?
ICT.
ICT.
I just was wondering, so how that kind of rolls with somebody who's on the case management program, but then there's the ICT process, and how this, I'm just trying to figure out the nuances of how that would flow in terms of for the member.
So an ICT, interdisciplinary care team, can be requested by the member themselves, a caregiver, a CVAS provider. When we are reviewing an assessment or their care plan or the information that we're asking now on our care coordination form, that will often also trigger an ICT to be set up. And then we would reach out to providers who are involved, and of course the member and the caregiver being impacted by that as well. So, you know, there are multiple points where we can, you know, set up an ICT. Hope that answers.
I think we have some input on the online here.
Just backing up a little bit, Diane had a question. Relative to Ruth's question, do you have information about diagnoses at the time you are contacting the member? which might include a dementia-related diagnosis.
We do. So information that's sent to us on the 34 file, also if we have an HRA, you know, complete as well.
Okay.
Sometimes we do.
Okay,
go ahead.
I'm sorry, Diane had a question previously when you first started, Selena, and we just kind of, we missed it. I don't know if it's been answered already, so forgive me, but she asked, if risks are identified, will you then coordinate with the CVAS Center to address them, or what happens from there?
If risks are identified, such as,
like dementia or...
I think she's saying if the health risk assessment, kind of related to my question, if this, Lydia, if the health risk assessment indicates there are a number of high risk factors related to this person's situation in HealthNet's system, does that sometimes lead to a referral? I know Anthem talked about how that'll go to a case manager and then they know to make a referral if it's appropriate.
And it does as well. If we're talking about referrals to a CVAS or another LTSS provider type, right. Again, if we have that information, so that goes back to the original point. It's just getting that HRA to begin with.
Right.
And it's probably those high-risk folks that are the least likely to fill it out or talk or return a phone call or open an envelope.
Right. So that's the starting point.
Yeah.
And Diane says, yes, or if already served in CVAS, will there be communication on the identified
coordination
CVAS center?
Yes.
So, and recognizing that we're all still building this coordination and building on the HRA, that this is a great conversation for helping us sort of brainstorm around what additional things we can build on.
We're learning here as
well. That's great. Well, thank you, Selena and Amanda. And next up, I think we've got Anna. You're ready to go, Anna.
I'm so ready.
She's been warming up.
Great. Sorry about the technical glitches. So, I did not necessarily prepare an official document for you all. I'm sorry. I wasn't aware if I needed to do that. But listening to the other presenters, I appreciate their sharing their successes and challenges. And I think I think that all health plans can relate to certain common challenges to completing the HRA. And those being the information that we get from the 834 file, continued challenges as far as the address and contact numbers. We do have an HRA vendor that has been very successful in locating alternative numbers, and we have a high success rate in completion for our CalMedi Connect line of business and fairly high for the SPD line of business as well. LA Care has a delegated model where we have our contracted medical groups really taking care of the more simple case management or ambulatory case management needs, and LA Care assumes the risk for members who are identified as high risk. And we identify our members as high risk through three primary ways. One, the health risk assessment, but not everybody completes the health risk assessment, so we have to rely on other ways. So the second way is we have a predictive modeling tool that we churn all membership through on a monthly basis. And through that, we identify changes in condition as the claims come in and so forth to see if the members have changed from one risk level to another. And of course, we rely on our partners either within our own organization or outside of the organization, such as our medical groups and or specialists or PPG or specialists or PCGs referring members. But for the health risk assessment, we take the answers and the nurse clinically goes through each one and basically forms forms a care plan, at least care plan objectives, to talk to the member about. And once we get the member and or caregiver on the phone, which also is a challenge, but once we do get them on the phone, we clarify basically what is the member's primary concern. You know, there are multiple issues, but primary concern. And then we add additional goals according to the, you know, severity or the thing that will meet the member's needs the best. So as it relates to the CBAS centers, sometimes the members or caregivers will identify that, yes, I'm receiving CBAS services. And in that way, when it's time to coordinate the ICT or Interdisciplinary Care Team conference meeting, we are reaching out to the CBAS centers to include them in the ICT meeting. Now, granted, this has been a work in progress, and it's an orchestrated event for a good ICT conference. So we just started getting participation from some CBAS centers. But I can definitely tell you that our MLTSS department is heavily represented in the ICP so that they are able to weigh in and give input if our case manager hasn't already kind of put it together in the plan to refer for a new CBAS referral. We also include the IHSS social workers as a state requirement, and so we invite them if they're receiving IHSS hours and that they're a regular participant now at the table with us, actually on the phone, but pretty much at the table. And let's see, I guess that's it. I mean, we maintain them in a high-risk case management if they're appropriate for our high-risk case management program. And if not, then we work with our medical groups to basically say, okay, you know, high-risk needs are met. And so, therefore, we're going to transition the care management responsibility to you unless there's a change in their risk status. And that's our process in a few minutes over the phone.
Yeah. Oh, Anna, this is Lydia from Kansas. I've got a question. Thank you for that great overview. Hi, Anna. So I was wondering if CBAS, we know by definition if someone is already in CBAS, when you get the data files, they're identified as complex high risk. And we know that right now there's no delegation of CBAS beneficiaries to medical groups. Is that status always linked? In other words, if someone is in CBAS, they are always going to be, by definition, classified as high risk? Or do you see a time when, you know, that could change and we might begin to see some delegation? Just curious if that's down the road or if I'm understanding it correctly today.
Okay. I'll probably have to answer the delegation to how to answer that. What I can tell you is that we have the CBAS basically indicator as a high risk indicator in our RNA. And that's initial high risk. So once we get through the questions, if a member looks like they are not high risk, then they won't be placed in the secondary kind of stratification as high risk. But, you know, most of the time people who are needing to have CBAS services are in the higher risk category. We do have, to my knowledge, correct me if I'm wrong, our members have PCPs and contracted PPGs. Gretchen?
Yes. Yep.
Can we interpret the acronyms there?
Yeah.
I'm not sure we got that right.
You're asking, say it again, it was breaking up just a little. Let me just make sure.
Well, Lydia was asking if the members who are in CBAS, who are identified, I guess, on the 834 file, that they're not assigned to our medical group. PPGs is medical group, sorry. So that's not my understanding. So if you could speak to that.
So they all have a PPG that works. I mean, they're all, they have, you
this
know,
is
they
people
have,
in CalMedi.
They have a physician, yes, in CalMedi.
In CalMedi Connect.
Yes. And, but if they are a CVAS member, then they are in the high risk category. So generally they stay there. Is that what you're trying to do?
So they stay with the LA Cares care yes. management, and you guys are at risk for
right.
them.
Right.
You're not delegating any of the risk down to the physician group.
Right, even though they actually will have a physician that's assigned
right.
to us, and they're in CalMedi.
Right, okay, but you're not delegating
right.
risk down to the right. physician group for those folks.
Right.
Okay. And you don't see that changing anytime soon. So. Don't think so.
Okay. So I'm going to get you a second. Let me just ask a question of Rebecca, if I could. We had said last time that we were going to get numbers from Oksana, and I don't know if you know how readily they are available for our CVAS population in the CCI counties, getting our hands on how many are actually enrolled in CalMedi Connect versus MLTSS. That would be helpful. I could, we speculate about it, but I don't know that we actually
I think that data is available, we actually, right, Rebecca?
Yeah, we know.
Yeah.
Have we not shared it?
No, we haven't. Well, I mean, at least I haven't
seen data in the past months and months ago.
Yes.
So I think
right.
Yeah,
I think it would be helpful to us.
Yeah,
to
exactly.
Numbers.
Yeah, it's a primary driver for the resetting. So it's
yeah. That would be really helpful.
I can check in with.
But it's very few. I think is the point. Proportionately. You know.
Yeah. I mean, I would assume that probably greater than 50% have opted out of.
Yeah, I'm certain. Yeah, I just think it's somewhere closer to like 10% is what I thought that we're actually in CalMedi Connect, but I don't know where I got that.
I think it's
from.
Yeah, 5 to 10.
A long time ago. So anyway, just so we're all aware of how much of this doesn't touch our CVAS MLTSS
right.
population. Okay, Ruth had a question.
Yeah, and maybe related to Lydia's, maybe a little different. I heard earlier today, this morning, that in some of the centers, there's a wait list
yes.
for the CVAS centers. And I wondered, on these people that are sort of identified as high risk, but the CVAS center has a wait list, MSSP often has wait lists, at least in the communities that I'm working out of, what happens to those people in terms of then how do we ensure that they're getting some sort of more regular connection to something? Because I doubt that the care manager is going out twice a week.
Right. I don't believe any of our members, you know, in LA, San Diego, anywhere actually that we're contracted with CVAS Center is on a wait list.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah.
I just didn't know if that was happening or if that was
different. MSSP is different, but for CVAS, I have not heard that.
Well, we have some issues. I think with wait lists is mostly San Francisco right now. And San Francisco is not a CCI county, so.
Yeah, but I think plans still have opportunity to provide unbundled services.
Right.
So maybe if we can target where those counties are that we're experiencing wait lists and see what the plans are doing to provide similar or comparable services to that population.
Right, a regular or some sort of regular oversight for their care.
What we do, we're not having a wait list in LA Care either, but for MSSP, if someone is on a wait list at day 30 of referral, then we actually have our social work take over and manage them until we get them into MSSP. So we do have a process for actually attending to them.
Okay.
If it's less than 30 days, it's so short to do much, then we wait.
Okay. I just wonder if there's a process for
that. Yeah.
Okay, so for the purpose of keeping the agenda moving, we've got Kathy Osborne from CalOptima who has some things to share about CalOptima's HRA, and then we'll move on to the next agenda item. Welcome, Kathy.
Hi, thank you.
Thank you for joining
us. Yeah, sorry I'm late. We had a mandatory fire drill, so I'm trying to play catch-up here.
Go ahead.
What kind of information are you looking for?
So we've had HealthNet, Anthem, and LA Care have shared a little bit about their HRA processes, their actual tools, just you know, sort of overview and some of the challenges they've been experiencing. So if you had anything just sort of general, there's nothing formal here, Kathy. We're having a working meeting, and anything that you think might help us as we go forward and talk about CVAS quality.
Okay. So. With our HRAs, we have a couple different groups that are working on them depending on how the member has been identified. If they're identified as high risk, then we have RNs doing them. And if they're identified as low risk, then we have PCCs that are doing them. And then we have a whole separate team that does the HRAs for the long-term care centers. And I can talk a little bit more about those because that team is within my department. They have a formal questionnaire that they ask questions from, and they are supposed to meet with the member face-to-face, and then, you know, there's options after that if that's not possible. And I would say the biggest challenge that I hear about is members that just they just don't want to respond to the questions. Some of them have gotten quite angry and yelled at them and threatened them. And but otherwise, it sounds like it's going pretty smooth.
Now, this is Kathy, are you talking about people in a long-term care facility?
Yes.
Okay.
That's just my team, but there's other teams in CalOptima that are doing members that are not part of the long-term care facilities.
How about high risk in the community, Kathy? Do you have anything to say on that?
I don't. I'm sorry. I don't know what our figures are on that.
Okay. Just curious if you had any sense of what the bigger challenges were there. Liz, do you have something?
Right, because I guess my concern, not only as a provider, but as someone that has aging parents that probably need to be in the center, if someone was to call my folks at home, my parents would be so mistrustful and so fearful, they would not answer any questions.
Yes.
Or they would say, you need to call my daughter that lives a thousand miles away. So
I guess we do that.
About this whole process, it's hard to put it on the center. I'm surprised you have centers that would do it, especially if you're helping them financially. But I'm concerned about that.
Yeah.
How many people fall through the cracks and what's the follow-up?
Yeah, and the plans are too. Kathy, you wanted to share a little bit about that? What it is you guys do when you have this challenge with getting the HR days done?
Well, we do send something out in the mail, like to give them the heads up. And then we try to make contact face-to-face. And if that doesn't work, then we send the we try to make contact by phone. And then worst-case scenario is we send the HRA to them in the mail.
Yeah. So I think
we do try to recruit family members. So like in the scenario that was just being described, if we're given permission, we will talk to family members.
So I think, you know, some of the facial expressions in the room, Kathy, just so you see, I think that, you know, this is something that we were talking about while you were on fire drill, is that when the plans are reaching out to the CVAS centers to partner to get the HRAs done, that maybe there's some opportunities here for us to, us being the department, CADS, to try to encourage more participation from the CVAS providers, because like Liz is indicating, it's like it's surprising to us that we would have CVAS ADHD centers that wouldn't want to work, partner with the plans in these efforts.
These plans, by the way, are not the plans that we're affiliated with.
So yeah.
Right. Yeah. We would be happy to work with you.
And we would probably be able to get you more information because we have the relationship with people trust us to have that conversation. Whereas if someone called me on the phone, I wouldn't answer a lot of those questions either.
Yeah.
I'd be like, who are you?
They're
very personal questions.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And then there are a lot of people who don't have care providers.
Right.
What are we doing for them? Are they automatically high risk if they don't have a caregiver and they're not willing to participate? Because they often should be, right?
Yeah, if they're CVAS, they're high risk.
And,
you know, the other challenge is, like we mentioned earlier, is identifying a caregiver, you know, or an alternate caregiver. And so that's where we could, at minimum, use the CVAS Center's partnership and support with,
Absolutely.
Well, if it's not the HRA, you know, can you help us identify who the caregiver is, who to talk to?
Yeah. Celine?
I just had a question, because it's all about the relationships and kind of the face-to-faces, which is most effective with this high-risk population, why wouldn't it happen at the provider level, like with the medical group, where we're actually getting their healthcare services delivered and making some type
of... It's a good incentive for the provider. Good question. So I think most of the plans said that they're lower risk or are taking place at the PBGs.
I wanted to clarify on Anna was just sending me an email. If they have the HRA and it turns out that they're moderate or low risk, they actually are then cared for by at the they're case managed at the physician level. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So.
No, I just was wondering that why, if they're high risk or you're trying to get the HRA, why it wouldn't happen at the at the primary care level.
You're just like automatically.
Yeah, having CVAS center doing it versus this. Outside vendor.
Think about the duals, though. The plan, if they're not in CalMedic Connect, the plans have no relationship necessarily with that doctor. So this is, again, where you've got a whole group that's not getting the full advantage of coordination of care because they're not buying into the CalMedic Connect idea.
Right.
So that's where the centers can be of value. I think we just haven't quite figured out how to.
Yeah.
We're also asking for the provider support as well in this. But our members are still accessing the centers, CVAS centers, far more often than they are even
physician
on a weekly basis.
Okay, I think for the purpose of moving the agenda on, I don't see any more questions coming in on the webinar. I want to remind people if they do need to take a break that we have passes to get down the hall and get back in the building if you need to stop and use the restroom. We could either stop and take 5 minutes quickly to do that now, or we could just have people go as they need to. So what's the pleasure of the group?
We're going to go another hour?
We're going to go another hour. I personally could use like 5 minutes.
Let's do 5 minutes. And then, Denise, what I was wanting to ask you to do then as you wrap up this segment of the agenda is kind of help us think about how to tie this to quality.
Sure, you bet.
We'll
and I think that is where we're going. So we'll take, let's try to take 5 minutes for people online, get a coffee break, or you go down the hall yourselves. We're going to leave the recording going, yes, Adam, and we're just going to take a quick 5 minutes, and we'll come back online shortly.
Whatever you do.
Okay, so we're back from our break. So we wanted to start off with just a few closing thoughts about HRAs, and so Gretchen, take it away.
You know, I was curious about whether the CBAS, those of you that are involved with CBAS centers are actually, and programs, are actually seeing some value from the HRA process. Has anyone realized any value from it yet, or is there some things that we could be doing that would be valuable to you?
Yes. We do our what we call a mini assessment.
This is Daisy from.
Oh yeah, sorry, madam. Thanks for doing my job.
Yeah, thank you. We do have a mini assessment, and we pretty much ask similar questions that would be asked, just because we wanted to find out first whether this person really would benefit from the CBAS program. And from then on, and this person may usually do not have yet any managed care membership. So we are not able to really identify which HRA managed form are we going to use, because they don't have a managed care plan. But we are able to identify already that they are they can benefit from our program. Then we proceed with the usual process of encouraging them to enroll in the managed care and then do the necessary steps thereof to enroll. Mm-hmm. But the HRA will never be a part of our staff once they come into the program the first time, because we don't have to, we cannot identify yet where they would enroll.
Well, and then aren't most of the plans limiting the HRA to CalMediConnect or your SPDs? And not people who've opted out. And you're not even a CalMediConnect county.
Right.
A CCI county. So, right. Yeah.
Well, we are going to be, we were, Selena and I were just talking about this. We're working on an APL that requires us to do a review of the assessments of our MLTSS members for opt-outs. And I think once we're all struggling to get that started, but I think once we have that, that could be a really useful tool, because we'll be looking at your assessments and saying, have you thought of those? Have you thought of that? So, but it, you know, maybe we can't answer this today, but I would be really interested, as you think about the HRA process, if there's things that we could be doing to make it more useful to you. As the CMAS Center, that would be really, really good feedback for us, I think.
And I think, Gretchen, actually, that's where Lydia left us before the break, was asking if we could try to frame this discussion about the HRAs in terms of what where we're going next with CBAS. And I think one of the main reasons why we talked about this last time and wanted to put it on the agenda today was because we needed to know what was happening with the health plans, have a better sort of sense of what you're currently doing, where your challenges are, and then to think about the data you're collecting, the data maybe that you're not collecting, which I think Amanda sort of referred to, and that we had a few ideas there, how we can maybe leverage that with our efforts with quality, with the things that we're doing, the things that we're tracking or wanting to track. So I guess, coming back around to where we started, Lydia, I think that it was an important discussion for just finding out what the status is. And then to think about, because this strategy absolutely is necessitates us sort of leveraging each other's efforts. So so at least that's my thought on it, Lydia. I don't have any specifics about specific data points or anything at this point, but I think that it was just where can we find opportunities to work together and leverage each other's efforts.
You know, I think the one thing that is occurring to me is that maybe the HRA is sort of preliminary. It's when they're actually being, they're on one of our teams and they're having a care plan developed. It would be so great if there could be more interface, I think, with the CBAS programs and what you're doing at that point. Because then you know it's a frail person who's high risk and they're in this process. Yeah. And you all have so much information, it would be really...
Right, right.
That's what I was going to say. I think as a point of case management, that the fact that you're integrating the CBAS center onto the ICT,
right,
so that you're really... we all get in our silos, and so knowing what resources are being positioned out there or what additional resources you can kind of leverage between the CBAS provider and the health plan.
I think we have some comments online, and we'll go to the room first.
Yes, and Diane had just commented earlier to your question, Richard. No, we haven't. We would like to see a direct connection to consideration of CVAS for those not yet attending when appropriate, or to coordinate for those who are at high risk who attend our program. And then Lynn had a comment. It would be ideal if the assessment of risk, high, moderate, or low, by managed care plans and CVAS centers were using the same definitions criteria, so they would be viewing participant risk through a similar lens.
The other comment, this is Celine, to Diane's point, I think that, the warm handoff, your case manager, whoever was talking about that, somebody who might refer to a CVAS center, it really, we're a visual program, so finding a better way to kind of introduce a CVAS center to the member versus somebody just saying, oh, I think you're appropriate for CVAS, but finding a process that could be better.
Mm-hmm. Ruthie, did you have a comment?
I did, and it's sort of on it's along this line, but kind of on a different theme. One of the things I was thinking about as we're having these conversations about the HRA and how it works in the different settings is, if we are going to be sort of a model process and what we're looking at is going to shape the way adult daycare goes forward for the coming 10 years, let's just say, or something like that. One of the things that occurs to me is as we are working with these HRAs, what a great opportunity to sort of lay down what should and shouldn't be included in them and make recommendations along that line. And one thought I had, for instance, is in the grant that we're working on, we're finding that plans inconsistently ask about or don't dementia and how they ask about dementia, even as part of their HRA. And some do and some don't, and some have no ability to even flag it. And I think, if we look at our data and where we're going with this, and if we talk about competency issues, one of the things that occurs to me is if dementia could be a flag for, if not high risk now, potential risk, it's going to be a pending risk, right?
Yep.
Could we not include that as a way to say, okay, now we should also identify a caregiver. Now we should look at what options in the community might serve this person now while we're still in the community before they're, sort of as a series yeah. of potential opportunities to serve this person more effectively long before we're doing it because they've been in the hospital three times. And now we want them in a CVAS program, if that makes sense. And I'm just thinking, as we shape this, I'm thinking, how do we articulate this type of thing in our recommendations for us?
You know, it's interesting. It's a little bit of a catch-22 with HRA for screening for dementia because the person often can't tell you they have dementia or their family's not on the line with you and then, But what the health plans do have the ability to do is run they can run a dementia diagnosis for all their members, actually. Mm-hmm. So it could be, or it could also be captured in the claims data.
So let me say to you, what we've run into is that, yes, they can run claims data on dementia if it's a primary diagnosis, right. But they can't find it if it's not, if it's only secondary, or if it's just written in as dementia, and if it's off, and over half of our folks aren't even identified, even though they are right. Yeah. So, if in the course of that is discovered, either through a CVAS center, or as part of that risk assessment piece, when they talk to a caregiver or another person, it certainly would be something you'd like to see tagged in their HRA so that it's in their medical record in some way. And calculated into the process.
Great. Irene, I think you had something to say.
I was just saying it's so underdiagnosed. I mean, was like 50% or not, the diagnosis not there.
Right.
It might be a physician education, too, about
Absolutely.
Well,
I just think piggybacked on that is would be flagging for making sure to get durable powers of attorney. Mm-hmm. Because that's something that happens so often, such an issue at every level, but certainly at CVAS is where it's too late for people to do powers of attorney. So early flagging would just really really help.
Could help.
So just to clarify, when you say flagging for it, you mean flagging if they don't have it, or
no, flagging for early dementia?
Oh, flagging for early dementia for that. Okay.
Yeah.
Daisy, you want to?
Well, incidentally, there's the denial.
Not only the denial of the person himself or herself, but the family. So that is difficult.
Another part identifies.
Yes. And Lydia? And then I think we're going to go to the people online.
One quick last thought for me. I'm thinking about quality and how we connect to the HRA. So one thing that came to mind is I'm wondering if, this is a bigger discussion, not just among this group, but if we could better tie participation in CalMediConnect for those CCI counties to quality. Because I think the pitch right now to people has been, you're going to get better care coordination. People don't even know what that means. And do I need another person snooping around in my life? What are they going to do? How can they help me? I mean, we even ran into this a little bit with our community-based health home project, right? Well, what's this nurse going to do for me? So I'm wondering if there isn't a better way to describe and think about quality underpinning CalMediConnect in terms of the consumer. So, I mean, that's beyond this work group, but maybe there's a way that'll kind of come out of our thought process. This has been very helpful.
Sure.
Okay, so if I would like to just try to go online to anybody who wants to jump in online and make any comments that they haven't made. We haven't seen any more typed comments, but if there's anybody who wants to speak up before we move on to the next subject, we'd love to hear from you. Don't be shy. You're here to work.
Yeah, I'm typing.
It is. Anybody out there in webinar land who wants to make a comment at this point before we move on?
I'm in pause.
They're all unmuted.
Yeah. No, everybody's muted because they keep being loud, but
people
have raised their hands.
Okay, people have raised their hands.
Yeah, but there's nobody right now.
Okay.
The best thing is raise your hand.
Okay, then, yeah, make sure you raise your hand or type something in if you want to talk because we want to hear from you. Okay, we're going to move on. Thank you. I think that was a good conversation, yeah. Very helpful. Again, we're still laying a little bit of foundation here, but I want everybody to also keep their eye on what we're actually moving towards so that we don't have a feeling of, like, what are we all doing here, just educating ourselves? We're actually going to produce something, so I want to move on to talking about that a little bit. So the next thing up on our agenda for today is to talk about, for us to give you a little bit of update, brief update on the Health Services Advisory Group CVAS focus study. So I mentioned this at the top of the meeting, and this is really actually very, very exciting because the Department of Healthcare Services, actually all the states, are required by CMS to have what's called an external quality review organization, an ECRO, as they're known. And those ECROs are private consultants, and in this case in California, it's the Health Services Advisory Group. Very, very smart folks who track all kinds of things from Medicare data for hospital readmissions and all kinds of quality efforts that they're involved in all over the place. I don't know if it's beyond California. I think it is. But at any rate, we have in California, we have a contract as the ECRO. Our ECRO is HSAG. Health Services Advisory Group, and they do various things, including these focus studies. So they have to serve the ends of that DHCS quality strategy that we showed you earlier, there is some evaluation data that's done by the HSAG or it's done by the ECRO by HSAG to give us some barometers on how we doing with various quality measures. So these focus studies are very small efforts that the department is doing with HSAG to mine data, to take a look at a particular question about quality, and to see what's happening. And so we have been chosen to get one of these focus studies. So they're actually basically $50,000 grants that are spent. So there's not a whole lot of money that's associated with it. So it doesn't give us a whole lot of ability to go wide and deep in studying some interesting CVAS question. But it does give us a little bit of opportunity to, with the harness the powers of this advisory group to do a review of some CVAS data. So so we had a conversation with DHCS Managed Care and the executive director at Health Services Advisory Group just yesterday. I will try to briefly explain what I understand about what our opportunities are, and then we're basically just gonna have a few you know, a little bit of dialogue about it, and then we're going to leave it there for today, and we're going to further think through what it is we might want to have them do. We're going to meet with them in January to start laying out some specifics of the study. So basically what they were asking us yesterday is, what do you guys want to know? and we had had, fortunately, a preliminary conversation with Lydia, and we sort of, you know, thought through some things, and I think that from our perspective, what we wanted to know right up the top was, what can they do for us? So before we can even begin to formulate what's the question we want them to answer, what do we want them to study, we have to know what do they have access to. So for just a little bit about that, they traffic mostly in HEDIS data. So the what's HEDIS stand for? Health something. Information, data systems, I have it somewhere.
System, yeah.
Maybe, Lynn, I know you're out there. Type it in if you can remember what it is. I have it in my documents here. But at any rate, HEDIS data is what's healthcare effectiveness data and information.
Oh, that's it.
And so these data are provided by all kinds of healthcare providers. The managed care plans have to track all kinds of HEDIS data, and then they have to report certain subsets of that data to Department of Healthcare Services under their contracts with DHCS. So this data set is huge, and the managed care plans have to report a lot of it to the to DHCS. So mostly what this study will revolve around is looking at HEDIS data that the plans provide to DHCS, coupled with whatever data we want to supplement, and which was the good news of our conversation, just our early conversation yesterday, is that if CDA gives up some amount of data, we have participant characteristics data that providers give us. It's now, fortunately, participant identified data, so we have the SINs. So we have the ability to produce a chunk of data that we think is interesting. So maybe it's individuals who have diagnosed dementia, because remember we had that discussion.
Right.
We only track diagnosed, but maybe we want to ask a question about those folks or people who have three or more ADL functional assistance level needs. Maybe we want to look at people who are getting certain kinds of services. We have a data set here that the providers give us that's participant level data that we could provide to HSEC, okay? DHCS also has data that they can provide to supplement what the HEDIS data is. So if DHCS were to give up some chunk of data in the med system, for example, where they have all kinds of information about members around languages spoken, ages, ethnicities, there's all sorts of data that's in meds on the eligibility side. There's all sorts of information that comes in through HEDIS. There's information that we have. So I think that what we sort of preliminarily sort of arrived at yesterday was that we need to figure out focus on some small, relatively small question that we want to know answers to about who are the people that we're currently serving, some characteristics about them, and maybe what's happening with them, what's happening with like populations who don't get CVAS. So we have to sort of formulate the question that we want some information on, and then we're going to be able to harness the power of these of this data crunching organization to give us some analysis of that. So I think that you know, next steps for us is that we need to get a little bit more clarification of the nature of the data that that comes to DHCS from the plans. I understand the data that the advisory group will look at is not claims or encounter data. It's actually what they have, what's flagged in the HEDIS data for certain kinds of hits. So CVAS participants, for example, are flagged. So with regards to the other identifiers that are flagged in HEDIS, we can identify what's happening with the CVAS participants as a subset of that HEDIS data. So I don't want to like twist your brains around this too much today, but I do want to just like have you leave you with this point. We have a great opportunity here to take a look at some of the people that we serve and ask some interesting question about that. Ask some question I would hope that would inform going forward what we want to
you know, considered in the quality area? What kinds of characteristics do people have? What kinds of services are they getting? What are the costs associated with those or estimated costs? And what's happening with like populations out there who aren't getting CBAS? So again, lots of limitations on the data because, as we know, we don't have certain data available to us because of the limited number of individuals who are CalMedConnect, the limitations on the Medicare data, et cetera. But there are a lot of things that are available. So probably next steps are getting more specifics about the actual data elements that we could look at and then start thinking about the data that we have here at CDA, data that DHCS can sort of give up, and what we can put together to formulate a little focused study. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Lydia. So, from an understanding, because in order to access CBAS, you have to be in a managed care plan, then theoretically, all beneficiaries who are CBAS are going to be part of a HEDIS data set, are going to be included in the HEDIS data set, whatever that's capturing, right?
I have to admit that I am not an expert on HEDIS and how anyone in the room is.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's okay. But I think it could be something we research for our next meeting, maybe, or, you know, to try to understand really how the health plans are using HEDIS data and where did the CBAS go wrong.
I would be a great question to ask the plans. They have people in each of the plan that knows HEDIS inside now.
Right,
so
right.
If we just, you know, even Sarah Brooks could put out a little memo to say, knowing what you know about HEDIS, what you know about CBAS, what one or two questions would you like to know? And just ask the plans to send that back and see what we get.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, and that's the other possibility. Again, I think nobody's interested in asking any more from the plans as far as they already have specific marching orders for reporting.
Right.
We just had a recent, in November, we had a brand new all-plan letter that came out spelling out what they want for 2016.
Right.
But there are some abilities for us to ask for a few select data points if we wanted to go above and beyond that for a one-time thing. So we can ask for that as part of the focus study. So, but again, I think what we're looking for primarily is to use what they're already required.
And HSAC already has access to all that HEDIS data.
Yes.
So if we can mine that data versus asking the plan to generate something else, that would
look
better.
Absolutely.
Okay. But no claims data, so there can't be any cost analysis, right? There's no claims data.
That's correct. It's not claims or encounter data. It's basically what these HEDIS data sets are that their plans are required to track, and then they're flagged for CBAS participants as part of this. So we could take that subset out and see what data is getting. They refer to it as HITS. And again, Lydia, this is preliminary for me. It's like I'm not really clear on the difference between claims, encounters, and HITS and all the things that are reported to DHCS. But the HEDIS data that they were talking about is what HITS there are and how they would overlap with CBAS. So,
just a logistical question. So, Tell us what the time frame is for this. I'm sorry. I know you said we're going to look at it again in January, but I just wondered what would be the time frame
for
gathering that data and then being able to use it in some meaningful way.
Right. So I don't have all the timelines. All I know is that HSAG is basically ready to begin mapping out the study in January.
Okay.
So so I would imagine they're going to be doing look back data. They're not going to look at 2016 now. 2016 reporting is for 2016 measurement year is for 2015 reporting year. So there's a difference between reporting year and measurement year. So but again, I don't know. I would imagine it's going to span a few months in early 2016. Okay, so we have some work to do on this, and so more information gathering on our part and sharing with you, and sort of just wanted to plant the seed today for thinking about what are the interesting questions we want to know about what's happening with CBAS.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the HSAG. Is there anybody, anybody online that wants to ask a question or chime in? You can raise your hand. Otherwise, we're going to move on.
Oh, yes, I've got the Osborne here.
Okay.
There we go. You've got to see you're on.
Kathy, you want to?
I'm sorry. Yeah. Sometimes it's really hard to understand. The quality is not always so great. But can you repeat what you mean by not claims data? Because we at CalOptum, we're trying to get as much data as we can, and we're setting up like a work group with the centers to find out what would be helpful for them. But most of our data comes from claims.
Yeah, so Kathy, I can't tell you anymore. I wrote that down on my notes from our meeting yesterday with quotes around it, that they said they talked about it being hits as opposed to claims and encounter data submission. So my understanding, limited understanding of that, is that the plans are required to submit encounter data, and they're required to submit these HEDIS data sets. And so those HEDIS data sets where an individual thing is flagged may or may not have anything to do with an actual encounter, but it's something that the plan is reporting on about a known characteristic or service of an individual. So beyond that, I can't really tell you the difference between that, but that's what they said explicitly. It wasn't claims or encounter data. Lydia?
Okay. All right. Thank you.
More to come.
That's okay.
I don't know if it's helpful, but there's 81 measures across 5 domains of care.
Yeah.
So it's things like asthma medication,
right,
or breast cancer screening and things like that.
Yeah. And if you were to look at, again, there was a all plan letter that the managed care plans get letters, just like the CVAS providers get all center letters, that laid out new requirements for the managed care plans for reporting. And so that came out on the 16th, I believe, of November, and it goes to what some of the external accountability sets are that the plans have to report. So it includes things like all-cause readmissions, ambulatory care, outpatient visits, emergency department visits, et cetera. There's a whole bunch of these measures that the plans have to flag and report on for their members. And so we can think through, you know, how some of these might be useful to us. Again, recognizing that some of them aren't going to be there for CVAS because we're not going to be seeing them. The plans won't have that data. Okay, more to come on that. It's a great opportunity, and we'll try to leverage that for our activities. So moving on, next up on the agenda, we wanted to introduce and talk about a work tool. And so, let me see, time-wise, we're a little bit
behind. You're at noon.
Yeah, we're a little behind. Mm-hmm. That's to be expected. Okay, so what we want to do, again, in introducing this today, that's about all we're going to do is introduce it. But I wanted to start the conversation today and then have us begin to think about how we start filling this in. And again, this is a draft. It's an attempt on our part to start honing in on the assurance and improvement, the part of the providers and the outcomes of the participants that are all sort of the charge of this work group. How do we start looking? What's the starting point? Okay, so for us, and please anybody jump in at any point here. For us, the starting point looks like, you know, what's in our, as Lydia says, wheelhouse. What's in our wheelhouse here at CDA? It's oversight and monitoring and what we do right now. So the starting point that on this work tool that we sort of have put together is, this is what the 1115 waiver requires us to do here in the state, and it's the Department of Aging, because we basically do this work under an agreement with the Department of Healthcare Services. So special terms and condition number 100 specifically says that we are going to, as part of this quality plan, we are going to assure health and safety of beneficiaries. We're going to assure quality and implementation of person-centered IPCs. And we're going to assure provider adherence to licensing and certification requirements. So really the only thing that's new here on this list for us, because this is what we've been doing for time immemorial, all the providers can attest to that from their work with us in monitoring efforts, is assuring the quality and implementation of person-centered plans. Okay, that's person-centered as defined by the feds. So although we've always been looking at care plans
and how what the care plan says about services and the need for services, and then that those care plans are implemented. We've always looked at that as part of our oversight. So for this tool, I just want to overview this before I sort of dig down into it and say that we believe that we need to start working with this work group and probably with some subset of you in between meetings to start filling this in and getting some things in play here, is that what we need to start talking about is, here's what we're absolutely mandated to do, okay? Here are the existing activities that we have to meet these requirements, and these are just placeholders, by the way. So this is what we do now to meet these requirements. Here are some additional strategies to meet these requirements. So I'm here to tell you that I've been doing this for more than a couple decades, and that even though what we're doing is assuring that providers meet standards for participation in the Medi-Cal program for CVAS, that not all providers are created equal, and that some of our providers are meeting those, more than meeting the minimum standards, they're exceeding the minimum standards, but that our job is to find out if they meet the minimum standards for participation. So while we have existing activities in place where we assure certain things, we're assuring it at a minimum level. So it's something to keep in mind as we start thinking about what do we want to do to have additional strategies to meet the requirements. What kinds of things do we want to track? Do we want to sort of score? Do we want to compare among the providers? What kinds of things do we already have data points for that we might want to start enhancing and looking at to get at something beyond what we give in the way of a stamp right now, which is you're certified or you're not certified, right? So looking at something that gets a little bit qualitative around this. So existing activities, I think that we need to inventory some of those things, and I can give you some insights about that. Additional strategies that we want to put in place. So additional strategies, to just give you some ideas, they were on that framework document. Some additional strategies might be that we do training, okay? That we have some competencies that we have right now, regulatory, statutory waiver requirements that providers do training. That they do training in provide with all of their staff on a quarterly basis, that they have to train their staff in certain kinds of, minimum kinds of training orientation in the first 6 months of hire, that they have to ensure that their staff understand how to provide the services to the special needs of the population served, to the ethnic groups, et cetera. We do not do a lot of work in this area right now, and we could make that our sort of strategy, is to leverage our training among the managed care plan plans out there, among the CANS organization, providers work together to do some new training efforts and track those training efforts, providers that have completed it, et cetera. So the minimum standard that they meet the minimums, and that we have some way of tracking some additional things that providers put in place to enhance the expertise and the ability to deliver care. So just sort of trying to pique your interest in some of the, what we mean by additional strategies to meet these requirements. So lots of ideas and things that, again, that we do already, but that we could do a little bit more of. So we have been moving for some time since we went into the CVAS program and we started doing more reporting with CMS and we started having additional requirements. We have been making more efforts to do what we call provide transparency. Right, so we have a dashboard up where we know who's in this program, who's served. We're providing, deeper and deeper levels of information about that on our dashboard. We're providing information about the providers, who are the center owners. I just, shared all that with you. We put all that up on our website. So greater levels of transparency, perhaps some of this, the strategy could be finding ways to do comparisons among providers of, are you in the 90 percentile or in the 50 percentile in meeting certain kinds of criteria? What are the kinds of deficient practices that you've had? Are they health and safety related? What's the scope and severity of those things? Where do you fall among your providers? So there are greater levels of transparency that we can do. Standardizing of forms and processes. I think that there's some benefit to that, and we're going to talk about that a little bit in the IPC group. So there's a lot of different strategies that we can employ, and we can dig down deeper in some of those ideas that, we've been kicking around and chipping away at, and talk about those as we go through each of these items.
But that's what we mean by additional strategies to meet our mandates, right? And again, we don't just have to deal with the mandates. We can go beyond this, but this is the starting point, is to talking about quality. How do we assure the minimum things that we're required to do right now? And then we have measures and how to evaluate. So we can talk about existing measures that we have in this column. So in thinking about, so the deficient practice one, and I know this is, you know, for providers, this is a real painful spot, but just to use that as a starting point. So when we conduct a survey, we have a number of deficient practices that we identify, and we have a nature of those deficient practices. And so maybe there is a way to take measures that we basically use only internally right now to prioritize our work, to know where we need to pay attention to different providers, where we have problem spots, et cetera, and make, turn those kinds of existing measures into something that works for everybody, that drives that quality. So that's another sort of column that we think that we need to sort of walk through and start talking about all these things. Yeah,
I just have a question to help me get my mind around this. So maybe just, this would be just off the top of your head. So like, what might be an indicator of safety that you would, just so I can get kind of more into the real world, what would be an indicator of safety that we can measure? Just an example.
Sure. So there's, it would probably be helpful for me to share, backing up from that, Gretchen, just a little bit, and saying that if you look at our laws and regulations, we have a health and safety code, and we have a welfare and institutions code. Health and safety code has all kinds of things in it that don't have to do with health and safety. When we look at health and safety kinds of findings, it's in the nature of the regulation or the statute. So I'd say the first thing we would look at in looking at, could you bring up the standards document on our website, and we'll just show you this. So standards for participation as a CVAS provider in Medi-Cal, there's five main categories that we break it down into. Mm-hmm. So there's facilities, okay? Mm-hmm. So facilities have a lot of health and safety things associated with them, so mm-hmm. obvious things. You go into the facility and the heater's broken, and it happens to be last week when it's absolutely freezing cold, and we've got some real risks. Little old people sitting in bundled up in, you know, hats and jackets, and perhaps there's some threshold beyond which we shouldn't be having those people in the facility because their temperatures are too low. So there are things like that that are sort of obvious health and safety kind of implications, meaning there's potential for harm or there's actual harm going on, and then there's sort of a scoping of that as to that we do. How big is it? How bad is it? So if the heat's off and it's off for a half an hour, that's one kind of a problem. If the heat's off and it's 40 degrees and it's all day, that's another kind of problem. So there's ways that we kind of look at it, and I don't want to like bore you with all the sort of layers that we put on it, but health and safety, you know, in the facility area, I think is a really obvious one. So then the next category would be under administration. So these are, you know, sort of in the rules around the program. How is the center organized? Do you have leadership in place? Do you have infrastructure in place, policies, procedures, et cetera? Are people trained? Is there somebody steering the ship, right? And then we have the next major category, and there's all kinds of regs and laws underneath each of these categories. We have staffing. So are all the required staff in place and the required numbers? Do they have the required competencies, et cetera? Then there's the service component, which is, are they providing all the required components of the ADHC CVAS program, et cetera? And then there's the sort of outcome for the participants. So there's the participant care delivery. So there's health and safety issues at all levels is where I'm going with this. And again, it comes down to what's the nature of the problem. How big is it? How bad is it? What's the impact of it? So there's a lot of things that we do to sort of evaluate that when we look at problems with provider deficient practice.
Actually, this is a good framework.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So to come back out of
you
this,
internally,
and
do you internally rank those deficiencies?
Yes, we do. Yeah. So we don't have any authority like nursing facilities where they actually have scores, and it's in federal regulation. But we have a very similar thing. So to just sort of, you know, back that up just quickly to talk about the sort of evolution here. When I first started here, and for like from the time of the beginning of the program until 1992 when I joined, that we had, and a little bit beyond, we had mostly a auditing kind of process in evaluating providers, sort of backroom, retrospective, looking at books, looking at paper. Then we moved, just like everybody did with OBRA and the nursing facility reviews, we moved back out on the program floor and started looking at outcomes, right? So we started, you know, down that path and looking at participants and looking at the care that was delivered and trying to look at point in time. Also along the way, we started working with our DHCS colleagues at audits and investigations, and we were focusing more on medical necessity. So our reviews have gone more to an outcome kind of a review process. And because we have limited resources and limited time, what we are starting to migrate back to is a little bit more structure and process, because we realize that that's, we've got managed care plan partners now that should be looking more at level of service need, at medical necessity, et cetera, at participant outcomes and how well the services are going. We still are going to look at that, but I think that this is part of what we're thinking as we move into, you know, sort of mapping this out, is what strategies do we want to put in place to make sure that we do have better competencies in place, better training in place, better structure in place for programs to be successful. And so, you know, in the sort of give and take of it, I think that we're going to be focusing more in future, and this is probably something that we need some help, especially from, you know, providers and managed care plans about, is in retooling some of our oversight processes to kind of come up to date with where we are now in managed care. Okay, so it's getting warm in the room. We're getting towards the end of the morning here. So I think that there's a lot that we could share, sort of in like a, you know, maybe a smaller subgroup or what have you, kind of conversation. But we think that in order to get started with sort of mapping some of this stuff out, that this work tool might be a good start. So does anybody have any input for us about this work tool and thoughts about beginning to sort of lay out what are we mandated to do with regards to quality monitoring and strategy? What are we currently doing? What kinds of additional strategies might we want to employ? What kind of additional measures might we use to see how we're doing with this? Thoughts about sort of next steps in using a tool like this?
It's a good start.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So I was afraid of if I talk too long, I put it on. This is not on our website yet. We'll post it. I think we wanted to talk about it today and talk about getting started with maybe filling in some of this.
So I think this is a great start. Okay. Really clear, at least, you know, in what we're looking at. And I guess I love the idea of something like this, that as time goes on, you may decide at, you know, DHS or Medicare services or whoever, as we move down this road, we may have the ability maybe to add other quality measures into this as we go along. Is that something that you anticipate? Is that
I was trying to articulate that, Ruth. Yeah, so exactly. So what we just filled in on this tool is what we are absolutely mandated to do. And so we have lots of ideas of how we can improve what we're doing right now, and things that we might want to build on to existing things, and then new things that we could do. Measures for that we have to identify, but also if there's like whole areas where we want to, my personal sense is, frankly, that these three main categories, just about everything falls under these main umbrellas, is that how are we doing with health and safety? That's the basic minimum assurances that we're keeping people safe and we're not harming them. And then on the other end, we have, you know, adhering to all the laws and regulations. You know, I think we have some really good laws and regulations. My view is we need to update them, so that's part of the strategy, is bringing our you know, statutes into line with the new CBAS program, but we have some good stuff there, and then working on person-centered planning and making sure that we're meeting those requirements. So those are pretty big umbrella areas for quality focus. And if we were to loop back to the DHCS seven focus areas, that they encompass a lot of them. But absolutely, we can add on, you know, additional things that we feel like are priority areas, and if we have some great ideas for evidence-based practice promotion, best practice promotion, those kinds of things, training in those areas, we can work on that if that's what, you know, if that's where we want to go.
Yeah,
So, and I think that, you know, again, being mindful of, we don't want to add on a whole lot more work for anybody, including CDA. We're a little short on resources too. But so if there are things that we can do to tweak existing processes and or to build on without, you know, being hugely burdensome, why not? You know, it's figuring out how to get there. And to some degree for us, you know, like I was indicating, I think that we know that we need to change some of our oversight processes, and we've had a lot of priorities in the last few years, like everybody else. So for us, it's a matter of, you know, we're fixing a moving train, so we got to kind of find the time to start making those changes, and, you know.
I had another question. So when you collect all the data on the site, and you have that in some kind of a database at this point?
Yeah, so we have a database at CDA where we have, for every single provider, they have a record. We have a history of all of the surveys that we've done and the deficiencies that we've identified, and there's all sorts of information that we have.
And then if they have a deficiency, then that's a different issue, and that goes into another
process. Then there's a corrective action plan, and then we post those things, and we share that with you. But there's also a lot of other information, I think, that, you know, that's relevant that we you know, that we maintain on the providers, and, you know, we know staffing levels, and you know, we know a good deal about the participants that are served, et cetera. So there's a lot of data.
Where I'm headed with this is interesting, because what you all are doing is looking for problems in a way. And what I think we're here to do today is to actually sort of
yeah,
that
sure.
To what makes
right.
What makes a great center? What is the best
It's a great point, Gretchen. And again, I think that we would want to flip it and just talk about it in terms of, if we have providers that every time they report their monthly statistics to us, or their biannual participant statistics to us, or whatever it is that we that if they are doing that, then we would be saying yes, they're 100% of the time they're reporting, you know, appropriately.
It's sort of like, it's almost like thinking positively.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other thoughts on this as a tool, and then as far as process goes for, you know, sort of moving forward with filling it in? Would it be helpful if we took a little bit of a preliminary cut at filling in some of the existing things and then provided it back to you, routed around for people to give feedback? You know, I think that last time we met, we promised that we were going to do something in between meetings. Didn't quite make that happen. But we know that we need to in order to keep this train moving on time. So I think that, you know, we definitely need to get some things back to you in between meetings, have you give us some feedback so that we come back with something. We show some movement here in between meetings. Okay? So that will work. Any other thoughts on how we might work with starting to identify possible focus areas? I know, Lydia, last time you talked about some of the domains that you guys have been looking at, and I, you know, we've seen a number of other documents, you know, looking at these things. I think that some of the there are a number of things that we could probably try to synthesize a little better around. I mean, we know that we've got, we have some information on what NCQA is doing. We have some information on, you know, from you, from NATSA, some things that are happening sort of federally. We have the DHCS, even things that came out in the latest managed care plan directives around data collection. So we know some things that are being, you know, sort of, that are sort of beginning to form these focus areas. So maybe we can work on getting something like that out to you too, to help inform this.
Yeah, because, you know, it so much of what we might be able to do related to quality and measurement is related to what data is available, which
right.
Just starting mm-hmm. to get a grasp on right now.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe with this HSAC discussion and HEDIS, that
right.
seems like a really good place to start, because
mm-hmm.
that's the standard of measurement
yeah.
across the country.
Sure.
And then there are probably areas that link back up to some of those domains you mentioned that we're
right.
looking at nationally and at CADS.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking that might be a good place to start, is just to get a better sense of what
data points are already available to us before we start asking to collect yet more data from whether it's the plan or the centers. And that might just start us getting comfortable with, or used, maybe not comfortable, used to quality measurement in a couple areas where we know we can make it happen more quickly than, oh, we're talking 2 or 3 years down the road because we don't have data today. So,
and I think that that's got to be part of our strategy going back to what Ruth is saying, is that, so let's say we end this effort on time in June of 2016, and we say we've got a strategy, we've got a start, and it could be flexible enough so that as we gather steam with gathering some of the data that we begin to feed that in, but that we have a basic sort of, we have a starting point, we have a framework, but we can amend on it.
I think Diane wanted to sort of echo or from what Lydia is saying, says, I think the key is to streamline the administrative burden by using core tools to identify core measures, and it would be valuable to look again at things like the participant characteristics to make them truly quality-focused and meaningful.
Yeah, great. Yeah. Thank you.
I just want to echo some of that. I think one of the things we don't want to do is make this so burdensome that it's like what has happened with nursing homes, where there's just so much data collection. On the other hand, one of the things that I think is difficult and I've heard a lot of discussion around today is sort of the idea of what constitutes quality. Mm-hmm. Right? What does it look like, especially when you're developing programs that we haven't had before.
Yeah.
And so we're all sort of developing this idea.
Right.
And I guess one question I had, and I don't know if there's room for this, but I wonder if there's a way to also look at or measure or at least capture innovative practices, trends, or emerging trends where facilities, agencies, CBAC centers are starting to try to respond to a community issue that is maybe not everywhere, but it's an issue here, and we really need to find a way to serve this population in a unique way, for instance.
Right.
And I know a lot of the centers are doing that kind of thing. So if we also are talking about rewarding in some way, positive behavior as opposed to kind of having a
stereotype.
My thought is if we can start to do that and then measure those outcomes in some way, either have the center decide what that looks like.
Sure.
But I just, you know, again, sometimes I think we get stagnant in looking at what's going wrong as opposed to looking at what new things, what developments are happening.
And Ruth, what you just said triggered a thought in my mind. We want some measures that are statewide and global, and really be careful about how we pick those.
Right.
And there could be quantitative and qualitative. So we could have process that relates to quality as well as measuring outcomes and numbers. And then what I think what you're talking about is really important too, because we at CADS and ALE have been working with some of our centers and their plans to begin talking about, for example, pay for performance. So there could be some unique things, and I'm thinking now of Celine and Partnership and Dawn, where we've started to discuss with Partnership Health Plan pay for performance, because they're already doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So now the conversation's around, well, how can CBAS participate in that? It's going to maybe look a little different, maybe not. So that could be unique to a community like you're talking about. And that would be great for us to understand and capture, but I think the charge of this group is really to look at the global statewide, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we should be attentive to those because that's where the labs and the experiments are going to inform, I think, you know, the larger group.
Right. Well, and the other thing is you don't want a program like that to take them so off track.
Right.
They're no
longer
able to attend to the things that really constitutes quality in that program.
Right. Now, it's all got to somehow mesh. And at the end of the whole discussion, make sure it's relating to the person that we're serving, and it's something relevant to their well-being and lives, right? We start getting esoteric just because the data is driving us in this direction, but it really isn't meaningful. So, it's a meaningful part of it, right? It's a big puzzle to put together.
I know there's just a couple things. There is a company in New Jersey who she does some special things in her center and has, I can find out from her what they are, that she's actually, her center, if they meet all these qualifications, gets a higher rate from the managed care organizations in New Jersey. So that's, I can find out what her standards, you know, what she has. The other thought I had, and you guys may have already covered this, and I apologize, is what if it was a rating scale, kind of in the 1 to 5, where you would be having both, you know, both sides, the positive psychology and the, you know, the regular psychology. So you get the 1, you know, sorry, that's an odd reference, but, you know, the 1 to 5. So the 5s are doing a great job, and the 1s case and how we're not just punitive.
Quality programs use the 5-star rating, so you don't, you know, it's not a yes or no, it's a...
Yeah. Well, and I had referenced this earlier in doing some research and prep for today. I had looked at the DHCS managed care performance dashboard, and they actually take all of the plans along the bottom axis here, and then they have whatever the measure is, and they have here's who's in the 90 percentile, and they have the plans. So, you know, there are ways of sort of stratifying beyond just the 1 to 5, but sort of ranking. So those are all subjects for another day. I think, Lydia, one closing
comment. I just want to say, you know, this whole system is decades old, mm-hmm. the 5-star rating, and maybe not decades, but there's a gazillion dollars that have gone into that, all kinds of think tank. I mean, we are doing a grassroots effort here, so I want to just keep bringing us back to reality. We have no grant funding. We've got a $50,000 that HSAG is going to do something for, and this is grassroots. So let's stay real in terms of, you know, what we can accomplish and get concrete and, you know, implement. But unless somebody's willing to throw a lot of money, research money at this, we're going to have to stay pretty simple and basic.
Good closing thought, Lydia. Did you have a closing thought, Gretchen?
I don't want anyone to throw a tomato at me, but I know that your work is to keep people out of nursing homes, but we've been also looking at what we call long-term care nursing facility for people that live in nursing home at quality indicators for them. Mm-hmm. And I just want to mention there's a really good CMS-funded website called Nursing Home Compare, and it has, they've really just gone crazy with indicators, but there might be, you know, a couple of ideas in there that would also be applicable to us.
That's good. Take what's already been done.
Back to basics.
So there might, we'll look into that for some, see if there's some other good ideas, but I can't resist it, because besides the keeping people out of nursing facilities, it also just bringing people better quality of life, and I think that our CVAS providers would say that that's absolutely what they're about, besides the end goal of avoiding institutionalization. So great closing thoughts. Also, I think Amanda just piggybacked us directly onto the agenda by reminding us that there are sort of overlapping issues here, because she's on the other work group. And so overlapping issues, you know, we're going to meet and talk with the IPC work group this afternoon. Some of you are going to leave us, and some of new people are going to join us. So for the people who are leaving us, thank you for participating. We'll carry forward some items into the discussion today, because the IPC and sort of the standardizing of that and what new fields we're putting in there for tracking, et cetera, tweaks we're making there will also help to, you know, move the quality initiative forward. So, and we have actually the overlapping lunch for the purpose of talking about some of those issues. And so for those of you who are going to stick around and have conversations between 12:30 and 1:30 before we start IPC, definitely the more, besides socializing and enjoying each other, the more we can share some of the things that we came up with today, that would be good for the whole effort. And so for the people on the webinar, if anybody has any closing comments, I see that Diane is saying that, as Lydia is saying, exclamation mark. So she likes what you say all the time, Lydia. She's your, like, you're like your Ed McMahon.
We are.
We're in lockstep.
We've worked together 30 years. So.
Okay, yeah, that's great.
And each other's sentences.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, is there anybody else on the webinar who'd like to say anything before we shut down for a little bit, and then we're going to start up again at 1:30, and if you're joining us this afternoon, you're going to sign back on. But is there anybody who wants to make any closing comments?
I just want to give everyone a newsflash.
Okay.
12 people are dead at Inland Regional Center. There's been a shooting.
Oh, God.
And it's just happened. 20 more victims than that. Inland Regional Center.
Oh, my God.
40 victims, 12. 12 deaths and 40 wow. victims now. Oh, so yeah. our prayers and thoughts to our security. Colleagues.
Wow.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So I just got that news update from somebody here and happened to have internet access. So, yeah.
All right. Anybody else on the line? Any closing thoughts?
Too close to home.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, well, thank you, everybody, for your participation. I think we made some forward movement today. Ball's moving downfield. I feel good about it. And we'll do more work in between meetings. Thank you. We're going to have lunch, and we'll sign back on at 1:30 for everybody who's participating all day. Okay?
Thanks.